So this is a discussion to the AS level paper one exam. So the one that I have sent to you. Question number one, which statements about the resolution and magnification are correct? The answer is A, because resolution is the ability to distinguish between two separate objects that are very close together. And magnification is the number of the times larger an image is compared with the real size of the object. So question number two, it says that an eyepiece reticule has a scale with 100 division, a stage micrometer, has a scale with 550 divisions, each of which is 0.040 millimeter apart. Using a 40 times our objective lens, the whole length of this stage micrometer scale line up with the 15 division of the eyepiece reticle. What is the actual length of the 100 division scale of the eyepiece reticle? The first thing that you need to do is to know that each of these, we have to first find out each division on the stage micrometer equals to how many millimeter, because that's the only thing that we can use as a reference. So each one division on the stage micrometer is 0.040 millimeter. And so it means that each 50 division of it, because it says a stage micrometer, so it's 50 division on the stage micrometer should be 50 times 0.040, which is equals to 2 mm. Millimeter. Now, because I need also to know about micrometer, because some of the answers are converted into micrometer. If I convert it into micrometer, it is 2 × 1,000, so which equals 2,000 micrometer. Now we need to know if each 15 eyepiece reticule, 15 division on the eyepiece reticule equals to 2,000 micrometer, stage micrometer. So how much is the 100 eyepiece reticule? So you easily 2000 times 100 divided by 15, it gives you 13,000 micrometer. But because you don't have any 30,000 micrometer, but we have in millimeter, I should change it back to millimeter, becomes 13 millimeter. I mean, 13,000 divided by 1000 becomes 13 millimeter. So the answer is B. Question number three. A prokaryotic cell, which is 1 micrometer in diameter, is magnified 50,000 times in an electron micrograph. What is the diameter of the cell? So the diameter of the cell is 50,000 divided by 1,000 to change it into, because that is mentioned in micrometer, so I want to convert it into millimeter. So we have to divide it by 1,000. So it becomes 50 millimeter. We don't have 50, so here we have 5 times 10 power 1 millimeter, which is the answer, and the answer is C. We go to the next question. Question number four. In order to save the time, I don't read it again for you. So it's just to know the order of the what is the order of the different organelles in the cell based on their density or magnitude. So as you can see here, about the structures that are from the biggest to smaller size are nucleus, then is Golgi apparatus, there is endoplasmic reticulum, there is mitochondrion, then becomes then lysosomes, there are ribosomes. Ribosomes are the smallest one. That's why usually on the diagrams or on the microscopic like photographs, it's not easily, cannot be easily actually identified. So the answer based on this would be B. So B is the answer. Question number five. So in which cell structure will the radioactivity first become concentrated if you are introducing radioactively labeled nucleotides? Nucleotides are to make RNA, DNA, and also maybe this part. So it's everything related to the DNA and on RNA. So you cannot definitely find it in the number one, which is endoplasmic reticulum, and ribosome has nothing to do with that. It's just center for protein synthesis. Or you can find it in the nucleus because it contains DNA. And also in number four, it's just to pack and assemble and form and shape the protein actually, which is made there in the endoplasmic reticulum, so has nothing to do with that one. So I have to look for another organelle which contains RNA or DNA, which is here mitochondria. So number three also can have it because it has its own DNA. So number two and three is the answer. So the answer would be C. Question number six. You may by looking at these things that the amylose, is made of the alpha glucose, and alpha glucose is C6H12O6. But here you should remember that it's just a bind between glucose molecules, and which is a glycosidic bond between the molecules, and is a condensation reaction. So one water molecule will be actually formed and released during each of these reactions. So it means that the glucose should lose one H2O every time. So it means that you have to deduct two hydrogen atoms and one oxygen atom from the formula. So it would be C6H10O5, which is N in the parentheses, and after the parentheses we have to put N with N times. So the answer would be C. And for example, another example I wanted to give you, like maltose is another sugar molecule. It's the two alpha glucose molecules, they bind together, they join together during the condensation reaction. But so in this time we have C12, because it's only two, do not need to write like that. So it becomes C12H22O11. There is a condensation reaction, but there are only two molecules of the glucose in the maltose. So for the maltose, the formula will be that. The formula also would be like somehow the same for the formula of the amylose, glycogen, dextrin. They will be also the same. All will be C6H10O5 N times. So question number seven, which is represented by the second number, 1, 2, or 3? Of course, the answer would be A, because A is the bonds formed by condensation, glycosidic and ester, or both of them are examples of the condensation reaction. Question number, part two is the carbohydrates. The carbohydrates are all of them carbs, and part three is the lipid, which contains triglyceride, vegetable oil, and ester bond between them. So answer is A. Question number eight. In unsaturated lipid molecules, where are double bonds located? Answer is C, because the double bond is only between the fatty acid molecules. It shouldn't be between the glycerol. The one that you find is not has nothing with the saturation, is the one part of the formula of the glycerol. You may say that the glycerol also has a double bond. No, that one is a part of the molecule. But here is just because of the saturation and is not permanent. It can be changed. It can get saturated. So that double link will be actually turned into one link. So one bond. So number nine, phospholipid and triglycerides are important biological molecules. Which properties are correct for these molecules? Nine is C. The reason is that the triglyceride is nonpolar, definitely, but phospholipid are partially hydrophobic. One part of it is hydrophilic, so it's not fully hydrophobic. And so C is the answer. Question number 10, answer it would be A, because We don't have ionic bond here. We don't have ionic bond at all here in the secondary structure. And this is secondary structure. This is alpha helix. It looks like alpha helix to me. And this one is the beta plated sheet. And these are these dotted actually line that you see, there are hydrogen bonds between these actually molecule of them. So hydrogen bond, and both of them you can find in SMT, but ionic bond never actually existed in these secondary structures. Question number 11. So question number 11, you should find which of them is the R group. R group, so you have the general formula of the amino acid is it starts with the N, then C and C, and here it should be two hash, and then in the middle actual carbon has one hydrogen and the other one is occupied by the R group, any R group. So it shouldn't be linked to N, as this is wrong. And also this is a carboxyl group. So I have to look for that structure. This is wrong, so it doesn't belong to R group. This is R group. This part. For the B, this part is R group. And for this one, actually this is wrong, which is attached to this, but this is, I don't know, it's been attached to that one. And yeah, because this part is not the R group, it's the main part of the amino acid. This is R group, and this is correct, so this is the answer. And this one is wrong because the chain starts from here, N to CC. So the R group should be this one only, which is attached to carbon. So answer would be C. For the both amino acids, so I just want to check one more time to make sure that, sorry, the answer would be D. Because this is the R group, this is wrong, and this is correct. Well, this is wrong. This is wrong also because it is actually highlighted C, which is belongs to the main chain of amino acid. This is R group. So answer is D. Sorry. So I go to the next one, which is number 12. Number 12 is answer is A, because when the pH of the environment actually decreases, it causes an enzyme, actually hydrogen and ionic bond. Between the adjacent R groups holding the tertiary structure are disrupted to become disrupted. So this is tertiary. And this actually, as I told you, usually when you change the pH and temperature, they can affect the tertiary and quaternary structure of the enzymes. Number 13 D is correct, because as you can see in the other diagrams that I already have show you on the whiteboard that last time on the previous session, this is shows for the non-competitive inhibitor on the enzyme activity, because I told you the Km here. If you continue, it has here for this one with the inhibitor Y, which is a non-competitive, it affects on the maximum rate of the reaction. So the Vmax here will be lower compared to the other because it sits on allosteric parts of the enzyme, which is any part other than active site of it. So D is the answer. Question number 14, I tried to move faster on the easier question. So which statement about the cell surface membrane are correct? Cell surface membrane contains channel proteins that water soluble ions and molecules actually move across the membrane. So the channel proteins purpose is that, so this is correct. Glucose can pass into the cell via carrier proteins. This is also correct. Oxygen passes freely because it is lipid soluble, so it is correct. Some glycoproteins act as antigens, so this one also correct. The answer should be D. Question number. So it is A, sorry, because all of them are correct. Question number 15. Question number 15 is, which of these features increase efficiency of ion uptake by a root hazard? Having mitochondria in the cell, Yes, that's actually it helps because it can increase the ion because the ions are transferred by the active transport. So of course they need more mitochondria we have, faster it can happen and facilitates actually this transport of the ions. The second one is wrong because it has nothing to do with the vacuole and the concentration of the ion. But the third one is actually it is very important because the protein carriers, the motor are in the surface membrane, they help facilitate again the ions uptake. So the 1 and 3 is correct. So B is the answer. Question number 16: what can increase the fluidity of the cell surface membrane at the low temperatures? One of them is cholesterol that we already know. Double bound carbon atoms in the fatty acid chain. Do you think that it is actually has an effect on it? So we say yes. So this is another property of that. So having a double bond and also shorter chain, they all cause that give them a fluidity. So answer is A. I move on to this number 17. So in order to calculate and see which one is correct, you just know to, if you do not know which one is correct, so is C is the answer because you can easily calculate the area over the volume and see which one, how much is it for each one, and then make a comparison. If you do that, you'll find C is correct. The other one, I move on into question number 18. In the question number 18, the answer is B, 8.9. Why is it like that? Because, okay, we know that in the interphase, in the C actually phase, S phase, we have, that's the time that the DNA starts to become condensed and become visible. But not in all part of the interphase, not all in the all of the different stages of the interphase, you can see the cells that they have the two chromatids. So I just omit this part from the answer, and we'll go just into the focus on the mitosis itself. In the mitosis, in the prophase, the two chromatids, sister chromatids, they join together from the they are joined together to the centromere already. So there are two actually chromosomes there, but in the metaphase they also still they are attached to each other, but from anaphase the spindle fibers they detach them and they actually move them, they take half of the centromere away into each of the poles, so we have single chromatids, we don't have two. So here from here onward we don't see any two chromosomes. It means that only in prophase and metaphase we have this. So now we see how many cells do we have here. 73 plus 16 will be the number become 89 if I'm mistaken. So and after that, how many overall cells are 886 plus 73 plus 16 plus 14 plus 11 becomes 1000 cell overall. Now we say that from in 1000 we have 89 says that they are having two chromatids, so out of 100, how many? So you easily, if you do the calculation, you find that becomes 8.9, so answer is B. Question number 19, which of these events are part of the mitosis? Interphase, telophase, and cytokinesis. Interphase is actually doesn't count into it. It doesn't count into it because that's before mitosis. Mitosis happens, and the telophase is the only one which is in the mitosis, but cytokinesis, usually they put it in a, after mitosis happened. So after telophase of the mitosis, we have a separate actually phase which is cytokinesis, and after that, it's a continuous more cell division. So answer is D. Question number 20, during which phase of the cell cycle does DNA replication take place? DNA replication, as I told you, always happens in the interphase and S stage of the interphase. So answer is D. Question number 21, which row is correct for guanine? So guanine, as I told you, it has a double ring, and double ring actually bases are called as purine, and it's actually bounds with the C with the three hydrogen bonds. So answer is A. Question number 22. In this actually one, in this question, we want to test our knowledge about the semi-conservative replication of the DNA. And here, you know that from each of the parents, one DNA strand will be passed on into the cell, into the actually new cells that are produced. So each of the offsprings, each of the cells of the offspring receive one complete, actually, copy, exact, actually, DNA from the parents, each of the parents. So when they put it in the heavy, actually, nitrogen, and the first time, all 100% become heavy nitrogen. So the parents, they are called 100% heavy nitrogen. But when they put it in the light one, so, and they are actually being the bacteria that start reproducing that. So the next generation will have half of their DNA will become from the parents, which is the heavy end, and the half of the other half is new strand. So the newer strand will be light, and the one which comes from the parent will be heavy. So 100% of each cell is actually a hybrid DNA molecule, but half of it is only a heavy DNA strand which comes from each parent. So the answer would be C, which is 50 and 100. Question number 23, I'm not sure if it was included into the question, but I ask you in which is the correct DNA triplet on the original DNA template that codes for the amino acid histidine. Histidine is GUA on the tRNA. Now I want to go back, one step back. So I see what actually the codon will be, the triplet on the mRNA. On the mRNA, it will be a CAU. And then I go one step back to find out what it would be on the DNA. On the DNA, so it's because we don't have U, and it should be replaced by A. And so we have GTA. So the answer is C. I hope it had been, you have understood this question very well and you have answered properly. See you again. Thank you.